5 plus 5 is equal to 10, right? And 8 plus 1 is only 9. So this is the shorter path. But when you square, of course, this blows up. But this becomes 25 plus 25 is 50, which is smaller than 64 plus 5. Okay. Okay. So assume that you are given a complete weighted graph, and all weights are distinct at positive. And assume that you are also given the minimal spanning tree T of G. You are also given a new vertex, Vn plus 1, and weights for all the edges between vertex n plus 1 and all the previous edges. Now, your task is to produce minimum spanning tree for the new graph. So this is when you get a new, if your graph is a dynamic structure, right, if it changes with time, right, the question is, once you find minimum spanning tree, once you find minimum spanning tree, and then you revise your graph by adding a new vertex. So here is your complete graph G. Right? So forth. And assume that you find a minimum spanning tree and say that's this in this simplistic picture. And then you get another vertex, Vn plus 1. And you get all of the weights of all of these new edges. Right? Now you have n plus 1 edge. So we know that when you run Kraskal, the complexity is n plus 1 squared times log n, right? So that's a large bound. Now the question is, can you produce a new minimum spanning tree for the extended graph in time only n plus 1 log n? We are adding n plus 1 new edges, yes. We are adding n many new edges, right? With all from vertex 1 to up to vertex n minus 1, and here is n, and here is vn plus 1. So the question is, you see, you cannot just add one of the edges and guarantee that you have minimum spanning tree, because maybe a path that goes through the, maybe you have to add two edges, right, and drop some of these and get a better spanning. Maybe even more edges, right, because the tree doesn't have to be binary. Maybe several of these edges can be added and some old edges deleted and get even better spanning tree. And maybe the new spanning tree will not be related to the old spanning tree. So how would you solve this problem? How would you construct a new spanning tree from the old one? Yes?
You consider the edges that you've drawn up in the previous spanning tree and the new edges.
Very good. So the trick is you take the edges, all edges that are of the form Vn plus 1 V1, Vn plus 1 V2, Vn plus 1 Vn, and we add only plus, you add the edges so that E belongs to the minimum spanning tree of the old graph. Now there are altogether how many n minus 1 edges here, right? Because for n vertices, the tree will have n minus 1 edges plus n edges here. So that's 2n plus 1. And of course, then Kraskal theorem, the quadratic part comes from the number of edges. But why is it that the new spanning tree will be cannot contain any of the edges that were rejected in the construction of the previous spanning tree, right? Because I'm here taking only the new edges and the old spanning tree and throwing away all other edges. Why is it that the new spanning tree will not have any of all the rejected edges? So it's always the same trick. How would you do it? Well, you simply say, okay, let us run Kraskal algorithm from scratch on all possible edges. As I run, whatever was an edge that is rejected because it connects the two points from the same component, is it possible that it will be added here? No, because here you have only new edges that might add connectivity, right? And as you progress through the Kraskal, obviously no edge that was rejected before can be added now, right? Because the edges of the old tree plus new edges, right, they cannot make components that are two points that are in the same component now become two points in different components, right? Because we preserve connectivity, right? We will add a new edge only when we connect points that were not connected prior to that, right? So if you run Kraskal algorithm on the complete new graph, you see that no rejected edge can enter into the picture. So thus, to revise the minimum spanning tree, it's enough to take old tree, add all the new edges, but this will be only 2n minus 1 edge, right? Because n minus 1 here plus n here, it's 2n minus 1 edges. And we know, of course, that then Kraskal will run in time O of n log n, because the quadratic factor comes from the number of all edges when you have to sort them. OK, any questions about this? So notice, yes?
Minimum spanning tree is a part of the graph that covers all the vertices, right?
Yes.
So if you join the new vertex with its shortest edge, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But now you have new edges that might be shorter than what the old Kraskal proposed.
So you add the shortest one.
Yeah.
So new vertex. So let's say it's at one unit away from vertex D, a random vertex D. That we assume is the shortest vertex. So if you connect those, shouldn't that be a minimum?
No, you see, because it might happen, that's a good point. You see, if you have a tree that looks like this and a new vertex, it is not necessary that you simply have to find the smallest of all these edges and connect here, because what the minimum spanning tree can actually make a loop through this and use several of these, right? So it can look, rather than being just attached like this, now it might look something like this, that you add both this and that and say remove this, right? So you cannot just add the shortest distance. It might be that several of the edges are used to revise the tree.
So
you don't just attach it, right? Because something like this can happen. When you run Kraskal algorithm, you assume now running it for the enriched graph, expanded graph with extra vertex, right? You sort all the edges and you go through the graph and look how it, through the edges, and look how it differs from the Kraskal run on the original graph, right? And the point is, in order to add a previous, to add an edge, right? It has to be between two disconnected components. But adding new edges can only make, can connect old components, right? They cannot, it won't make them disconnected. So adding these new edges and running Kraskal, it cannot happen that a rejected edge, because you see, the edge will be rejected because it's the two points, the two ends are already connected in old Kraskal tree, right? But new edges, right, will not make, cannot make things disconnected, right? They can only connect new the two components, right, the new edges. So whatever was rejected, it will be rejected here, because if this edge was not added by old Kraskal algorithm, it means that these two points were already connected, right? Okay, so let's see a few more. So you see, it's a Kraskal construction can be also used to you know, not just in its original form. So this is kind of a dynamic tree. How do you update a graph that can get new edges in a cheaper time than running the algorithm from scratch? Okay, we looked at this one. Okay, let's see at this one. This is a very interesting one. So assume that you are in a country. Okay, let me do it there because there is, well, actually, there is about, well, let me be closer to the camera. Okay, so assume that you have a bunch of radio towers. And you know their ranges, right? And their distances between all pairs. Now what you want to do, you want to use this radio tower in a tsunami warning system, right? So you want to put seismic sensors at some of the towers so that if you have an earthquake, the sensor can activate that tower. Now, when this tower gets activated, it activates, it causes all towers that are within the range also to activate. And as these towers activate, they cause other towers to activate and so forth. Your task is to find the smallest number of towers that have to be equipped with seismic sensors so that when there is an earthquake, eventually all of the towers will be activated. And, okay, so what in order for one tower, so in order for A to activate B, it means that the distance of AB, it must be smaller or equal than the range of tower A.
Okay, so
So maybe tower B has a smaller range than, say here, this is tower B. It has this range. This is tower C. So now tower A can activate B because it's within the range, but it cannot activate C. But once B gets activated, C is in the range of B, and it will activate this one and so forth. Okay, very good. So the greedy that works, but it's not that easy to see, is you start activating towers that activate the largest, but not, okay, so now that's important. You don't pick the tower that activates the largest number of other towers. So here is your homework. Show by a counterexample that picking towers with the largest number of towers in range might not work. So if you pick a tower that has the largest number, this might not work. That's pretty easy to see. It's about the same as the pinning example, right? But you are very close. You should not pick one that has the largest number of towers within its range, but that it has the largest what? What do you mean by range? Just total throw? Nope, this again showed that largest range will not work. Exactly. That's how it works. Very good. So you pick the towers that caused the largest number of towers to get activated. And this will work. Now let's see why this works. Now, so we are picking not one that has the largest range, but that it causes the largest number in total towers to get activated, because maybe this guy has relatively smallish range, but it causes lots of towers to be activated by cascade, right? Because this one will cause this one to activate, this one will cause these two to activate, this one will cause this, and so forth. So if you look if you look at this picture as a connected graph oriented graph, right? Directed graph. Sorry, it doesn't have to be connected. It's just a directed graph. What we look is for each vertex V, we look at S of V, which is the set of all, so say VI, it's the set of all vertices such that there exists a path from VI to V. So now we have to show that this will produce an optimal solution. Why is the solution optimal? What do you think? How do we argue that it's optimal?
Can I ask a question?
Yes. Yes, yes. So the goal is to pick the fewest number of towers that will cause all other towers to activate.
Isn't that impossible then?
Why? Why would it be impossible?
So if you pick the largest number of towers that gets activated.
We start with the tower that causes the largest number of other towers in sequence to get activated.
So you pick the largest chain reaction?
Yes.
Isn't that exactly what the question is?
No, it here says that, show that by counterexample that picking towers with the largest number of towers in range. That's fine. This says that picking towers with the largest possible range. You see, because a tower might have a largest range, but it might not be the tower that causes. It's very simple. Let's look at this example. You have three towers that are relatively close, plus two towers here, and this guy is in the range. This guy is in the range of this one. This one is in the range of this one. And this one is in the range of this one. And this one is in this range. And this one in this range. So now notice, this guy has in its range only this tower. This guy has in its range only this tower. While this tower has both of these in range, and this tower has just this one in range. Who has the largest number of towers? And in fact, maybe it's even the largest range, but these two guys are out of his range, right? Now notice, if you were greedy with respect of the number of towers in range, the central tower will be the winner because he has two towers in range. But these two are outside of the range, so you would have to activate this plus this, altogether three towers. However, if you activate just these two towers, they will activate these two towers, which would in turn activate the third one. So the third one is superfluous. Even though it has the largest range and the largest number of towers in range, it's not a good idea to activate it.
I got the question.
Sorry?
It's okay.
So now, how do we show that this produces optimal solution? So what do we do when we do greedy to show that something is optimal solution? We assume that it's not. So assume that there is a solution that uses fewer towers than what the greedy proposes. What does greedy propose? Greedy proposes to pick a tower whose, so to speak, chain reaction is the largest. Assume that greedy doesn't pick this tower. How do you get contradiction? If greedy doesn't pick this the optimal solution doesn't involve this tower to be activated. How do you produce a contradiction now? So this is the tower that causes the largest chain reaction that activates in chain the largest number of towers. But assume that there is a best solution that doesn't activate this tower. Why is this impossible? Well, if this guy doesn't belong to the optimal solution, there must be a tower that activates it through chain reaction, right? So here is this tower must be in the range of that tower. But why is this impossible? Because this guy would have a larger chain reaction than this guy. Because once he activates this guy, he will activate all the towers that this guy activates, right? But we assume that this guy has the largest chain reaction, right? So it's impossible that it can be activated by another tower because this tower would have a larger chain reaction than that tower. What can we do now? So this tower must be activated. Well, we can remove it and remove all of its chain reaction and continue, right? If the next is not picked by greedy strategy, you would have exactly the same situation. So you see, the story is really very repetitive. You assume that greedy doesn't produce optimal solution, and you either get an inconsistency directly, like in this case, or which amounts more or less to the same thing, you show that this quote-unquote better solution can be morphed into the greedy solution. Okay, so this is the deal. I'm going to release yet another homework. And the reason is I want you to practice greedy for the midterm, okay? So I'll give you a few greedy problems. And then next week on Wednesday, we will do both greedy, we will do divide and conquer, and a few other types so that we cover completely all the grounds for the midterm. And then you ruin your break by preparing for the midterm, right? We have a deal. Yes. Sorry, say it again. How do you calculate breadth-first search? You simply look for all points for which there exists a path, right? So you do breadth-first, and it will give you all the points that are reachable from that point. Good.